SpaceX is preparing to do something truly absurd. Of all the crazy things that this company has done, like launching a Tesla Roadster past Mars, catching a massive fairing from the edge of space with a boat and a giant net, and reusing a Falcon 9 booster over 20 times, this might be the most ridiculous and sci-fi feat. SpaceX is attempting to catch Starship's Super Heavy booster out of the sky after it's flown to space with a giant robotic tower. And although this might sound downright impossible and maybe pretty stupid, we'll explain how exactly they plan to do this. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, and today we'll go over the hardware involved, the flight profile, what exactly we can expect, and perhaps most importantly, why. Why is SpaceX trying to catch the largest rocket ever built in the first place? Okay, let's get started. This video is sponsored by Ground News. As of the making of this video, we're just days away from SpaceX's first potential catch attempt. Now, unfortunately, I can't predict the future, so I can't tell you how that catch attempt will go, but I can tell you what the plan is. But keep in mind that this plan could and likely will change in the future based on what they learn after the first attempt. That tends to be the SpaceX way. Try something ridiculously ambitious, even if the odds of success aren't very great, and then learn from the successes and perhaps more importantly, learn from the failures. Quick side note, this is a fairly short overview of this process. If you want a more detailed explanation on how exactly the tower and the booster operate during the catch attempts, may I suggest watching Ryan Hansen Space's video on this topic. Okay, so here's an overview of the rocket and the mission profile. Starship is of course the largest and most powerful rocket ever built. It's gargantuan, standing at 121.3 meters tall and 9 meters wide. It's the largest heavier-than-air vehicle to ever leave the ground. The Starship full stack is over 5,000 metric tons at liftoff, which means it requires a ridiculous amount of thrust to get it off the ground. So the Super Heavy booster calls upon 33 of the most advanced rocket engines ever built to get the job done. And of course, these are SpaceX's full flow stage combustion cycle Raptor engines. At T-minus 3 seconds, all 33 engines are commanded to ignite and they quickly spool up to nearly full thrust, which would be about 75 meganewtons of thrust. And once the engines produce more thrust than the rocket weighs, it'll leave the pad at roughly T plus 2 seconds. The booster ascends along its flight path for roughly 2.5 minutes, getting to an altitude of about 70 kilometers and having traveled over 60 kilometers downrange already before commanding most of its engines to shut down. But interestingly, the booster leaves 3 engines running so the rocket can do the ultimate in daring maneuvers, which is called hot staging. Hot staging is where you light the upper stage engines while the upper stage is still attached to the booster while it's running in order to increase performance and make starting the upper stage engines easier in some ways. Then at 2 minutes and 41 seconds, Starship accelerates away from the booster while the booster starts to turn around using the 3 engines that are running, the warm gas ullage thrusters, and by cleverly tilting the grid fins so the Starship exhaust reacts against them. At 2 minutes and 48 seconds, Super Heavy then lights up 10 additional Raptor engines and performs a boost back burn for 53 seconds, which changes its trajectory to aim back towards the launch site. For the first catch attempt, during this boost back burn, there's something noteworthy compared to prior missions. The booster and pad will have conducted thousands of distinct health checks during the first 3.5 minutes of flight. If the flight computers are happy and the teams at SpaceX see that everything is good on their end, a manual command will be sent from the mission's flight director, which will allow for the booster to target the launch pad for the tower catch attempt. Now, if the manual command isn't sent, or if the computers see any issue with either the booster or the launch tower, the booster will default to a trajectory that will have it splash down short of the launch pad in the Gulf of Mexico, similar to the prior missions. This call has to be made prior to boost back burn shutdown. After jettisoning the hot staging ring that gave the exhaust gas of the upper stage a place to vent while attached to the booster continues to fall back to Earth and eventually re-enters the atmosphere. The hot stage ring is a temporary solution for now, by the way. Eventually on upcoming boosters, we shouldn't see that anymore. As the atmosphere thickens, the booster uses its 4 car-sized grid fins to help control and guide the booster to its targeted touchdown site. Now, these grid fins use electric motors sourced straight from Teslas to actually provide the torque required to control the fins. And the booster will try to fly at a bit of an angle, aided by the chines along the edges of the booster, which allows the atmosphere more of an opportunity to scrub off additional velocity and makes for a slightly shorter boost back burn, which saves precious propellant. After all, even a cylindrical booster flying at an angle can produce some lift, so it can actually help extend that range even if it's targeted short of the launch pad just by flying it and gliding it through the atmosphere. So the booster continues to decelerate due to the atmosphere getting thicker and thicker, and therefore drag becomes greater and greater. Now you may notice that we skipped talking about an entry burn here. That's because unlike the Falcon 9, Starship's super heavy booster doesn't do an entry burn at all. Its stainless steel beefy construction allows it to skip the entry burn entirely, which is a very big performance advantage since you can use that propellant to accelerate the rocket on ascent instead of using it to slow down on descent. Right about when the booster is going through the transonic region, so transitioning from supersonic to subsonic, it lights up 13 engines for the landing burn. As the booster gets closer to the ground, it shuts down the 10 middle ring engines and relies on the center 3 engines to precisely control it for the remaining portion of the landing burn. This offers a big advantage over a single engine landing burn like the Falcon 9 because it allows the booster to be fully controlled on all three axes by the engines, unlike a single engine which can't control roll on its own. It requires assistance from the grid fins and cold gas thrusters to control roll. Three engines on the super heavy booster also can throttle down low enough to allow the booster to hover, which is something the Falcon 9 is incapable of doing because even one of 9 Merlin engines running at its lowest throttle setting is still producing more thrust than the rocket weighs when it's nearly empty. So the Falcon 9 has to time its landing burn perfectly. If it starts too soon, the Falcon 9 will come to a stop before it reaches the ground, and of course it'd either have to then cut off its engines and fall, or it'll actually begin to ascend. But having the ability to hover and precisely control the booster with just the engines is a huge advantage when it comes to this last important step, which is landing the booster within the arms of the launch tower, which is also known as Mechazilla. You may have noticed that I said land the booster on the tower and not have the tower catch the booster, because that's honestly probably a better way to think about this whole thing. It's unknown how much coordination the tower will actually have in the catching process, or if it's purely just that the booster is aiming for a GPS target and the arms will be at that point at the right time. Perhaps the arms do have some additional tracking and a way to adjust for some offsets, but we don't think that the arms will move up or down at all during the catch. But I guess we'll just have to see. As the booster closes in on the tower, it'll shimmy over and get within the reach of the arms. It'll slow down to nearly a hover as the arms are closing in on the booster, so the booster can land on these catch and lift points. The arms do have a small amount of padding along the landing rails to reduce potential damage to the booster. The arms will basically slap against the booster, and hopefully that ensures the catch points come in contact with the rails. And again, if you need a more detailed explanation on how exactly the arms can catch and orient the booster and kind of adjust and all that stuff, definitely watch Ryan Hansen Space's video about it. Okay, so back to the catch. The booster will end up landing directly over top of the launch mount, and the pad will actually re-engage the water deluge system, the same one that it used during takeoff. To be honest, I'm a bit surprised that this is necessary, considering it'll be down to just 3 engines, and it's at the very top of the tower. They actually will be catching it at the very tippity top, so it's quite a long ways away from the ground. But I suppose, why not do it if you have it? You might as well reduce the risk of damage any way you can, right? Okay, then at this point, just about 7 minutes after takeoff, the booster will shut down the remaining 3 engines, and all of the mass of the nearly empty booster will be supported by the launch tower arms. And this whole catch thing is something that we've seen SpaceX test in various ways. Between slap tests, where they took the arms and let them slap a test tank over and over and over, and weight simulator tests. They seem to have enough confidence to be able to put all the pieces together. Oh, and meanwhile, while all this is happening, the Starship upper stage will be continuing to burn until about T plus 8.5 minutes, propelling itself into orbit, or in the case of Flight 5, just shy of orbit, to continue testing the heat shield in extreme re-entry conditions. Oh, and speaking of the Starship upper stage, once they can confidently bring it back from orbit a few times and nail a pinpoint landing perfectly, they'll also hopefully begin working on bringing Starship back to the launch tower to be caught as well. So that's the exact plan on how this will all work, but what about perhaps the biggest question? Why? Well, before we answer that, let's talk about our sponsor, Ground News. Ground News is an app and website that gathers news articles from more than 50,000 sources globally and puts them in one place so you can compare how different outlets cover the same story. Fun fact, it was founded by former NASA engineer Harlene Coor, who worked on the James Webb Space Telescope and New Horizons. Let's take a look at how the last Starship launch was covered in the media. There were over 160 articles, and we can see visually where the biases lean on the bias distribution chart, with 26% leaning left, 62% center, and 12% leaning right. There's also the factuality chart and the ownership chart, which shows about 50% of these articles were written by media conglomerates, and these are things that can influence bias and framing. Then when we scroll down, we can see every article about Flight 4 and compare the headlines. I think it's fun to see what words are used in each headline, which ones mention exploding or test or Elon Musk. I personally enjoy scrolling through my blind spot feed, which helps me stay informed and balanced on topics and gives me perspectives that I might have previously missed. Ground News has been invaluable to me for enhancing my knowledge and critical thinking about space, science, and world issues. Subscribe through my link at ground.news/everydayastronaut for 40% off the Ground News Unlimited Access Vantage plan this month. That's the plan that I use, and I highly recommend it to anyone who wants to stay well-informed and gain a deeper understanding of the news. Okay, now back to why. Why is SpaceX trying to catch a rocket in the first place? Why are they taking such a huge risk? Why? Well, here's the answer. The reason to catch the booster is to increase the performance of the rocket, decrease the costs associated with ocean and even pad landings, and also decrease the turnaround time between launches, at least eventually. How might catching the rocket increase performance, you might ask? Well, to save weight on the booster, SpaceX was able to get rid of the landing legs. You can kind of think of it as having the heavy landing legs attached to the tower now. And if they are able to bring the booster down accurately with such great control, the actual catch aspect should be relatively easy. I mean, after all, they can already control the Falcon 9 booster to be within a meter of accuracy over and over almost every single launch. And the Super Heavy booster should actually have better fine control compared to the Falcon 9 booster. In fact, former NASA Associate Administrator for Human Exploration and Operations and current Vice President of Build and Flight Reliability at SpaceX, Bill Gerstenmaier, said that Flight 4's booster landing was within half a centimeter accuracy. That's astonishing. And this performance effect will be even greater on Starship, since it takes an even bigger performance hit with every kilogram of dry mass. But is this really all going to be worth it? Well, I mean, they've got to start somewhere, and they really see this as an important part of building a rapidly reusable system. The eventual goal is to fly the booster multiple times a day. If you need to collapse landing gear and transport the booster back via a ship or, you know, maybe a transporter or a crane on land, and then lift it and integrate it back onto the pad, you're chewing up a lot of time and resources in that process. So if you can skip those steps, you're removing a lot of steps to refly. And although this Flight 5 booster, specifically this booster B12, won't likely ever refly, SpaceX wants to work on these things now to get data on how to improve this process ASAP. And the final question might be, isn't this way too risky? What if it blows up and destroys the entire launch pad? Well, to that, I'd point to the first four Starship SN test flights, where they did those high altitude hops, because all of those blew up right there at the launch site with relatively minimal damage. And keep in mind, by the time the booster is landing, it's nearly empty. So it doesn't have much potential energy in terms of explosive power. So if something does go wrong, it won't end up putting a lot of energy into the metal shrapnel. It certainly wouldn't be a good thing, but it might not be as catastrophic as you might think. Or it's also kind of like how the first integrated launch of Starship created what looked like a full-blown nuclear bomb, throwing concrete everywhere. It looked bad. It looked really bad. But in reality, they were back up and running pretty quickly while also making improvements to the launch pad. And don't forget, there's already a second launch tower and pad under construction, so hopefully having another option online soon helps in regards to moving forward quickly. At the end of the day, this will be absolutely ridiculous. It's going to be perhaps one of the most ludicrous things ever attempted in the world of spaceflight. If SpaceX manages to catch the booster, I think it's safe to say they'll be nominated for an Astro Award. Which, by the way, we officially have tickets for sale for this year's Astro Awards in Austin, Texas, January 25th and 26th. There'll be panels with astronauts, professionals in the industry, content creators, special VIP speakers, and a huge party and celebration of spaceflight and space science. Don't miss out on one of the biggest and most fun spaceflight events of the year. For more info and for early bird discount tickets, go to astroawards.live right now. Okay, but what do you think about this whole thing? Do you think SpaceX will manage to catch a booster on the first try, or will it be a massive explosion? If so, when do you think we'll see a first successful catch? On the second or third attempt? Never? Do you think they'll do a few and it'll blow up and they'll just give up on it? Let me know your thoughts or if you have any other questions in the comments below. Thanks so much to my Patreon supporters, YouTube members, and ex-subscribers for helping make content like this possible. If you want to support the work we do here at Everyday Astronaut and maybe even have your name right here on screen, head on over to patreon.com/everydayastronaut. While you're online, be sure and check out our incredible merch store for shirts like this orbital shirt and a lot of new stuff, including our new 1969 collection, our prop load collection, perhaps most fitting for Starship, our heat shield collection, which includes our color-changing mug, button-up shirt, oversized beach towel, and hydro flask. Head on over to everydayastronaut.com/shop. Thanks, everybody. That's going to do it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.